Hello, brothers. My name is Addison Golden. I'm a current student at Florida Atlantic University Phi Alpha. And today we have a very special guest, a great alumni from the American University that knows a thing or two about student debt and all finances in general, the founder and chairman of debt.com, Mr. Howard Dvorkin. How are you doing today, sir?
I am great. I apologize for the delay. Apparently, we had a few technical issues. Apparently, I own one of the best domains in the world, and I can't operate a computer, apparently. So, and I have my son, who Scott Dvorkin, with me, who is a newly initiated brother at Syracuse University. So he's going to help me out today. And by the way, for you SU graduates or SU guys, you can haze the hell out of him when he comes back to school. And I strongly suggest that if you need some encouragement from me or ideas, I'm all about that. So please reach out to me. I want to make one note. I am wearing my letters, baby. So it's pretty cool. I'm enjoying this. I gave Scott my my letters and my hoodies, and from when I was a brother at American University back in 86, which is 1,000 years ago. And frankly, I gave it to him. The only reason I gave them to him is because damn things didn't fit. So he was nice enough to buy me some new stuff that actually fit. So with that being said, I want to go through and take a few minutes and talk about a couple of my favorite subjects, which is me, and tell you how I got the path. And I always like doing this when I presented at the AEPI convention. I started out as an accountant after graduation and worked my way up, and then said accounting is really not fun and it's really boring, and I decided to sit down and go to FAU's library and do my research for about 6 months, and came up with the business plan for now is what is called Consolidated Credit Counseling, which is the largest credit counseling agency in the world, and that morphed into debt.com and probably 100 other companies we have started over time. So it's been an interesting path. Debt.com is a very cool company. I enjoy building companies. I hate running companies. The fact of the matter is I love helping people. And certainly the one thing when I presented a couple of years ago at the AEPI convention in Fort Lauderdale, I told them about, you know, how I got to where I was, but the real question was, the more interesting questions that I saw were that people really wanted to know about credit. So last week I did a seminar for alumni about credit and what they should look out for, and now I think it was appropriate to do another seminar for brothers and the guys who are coming out of school and answer any questions I can for those folks. So let's go.
Perfect. So it sounds like you know what you're talking about. So just some questions.
Not really. I'm just good. I'm just a good bullshitter.
So what are some tips and tricks you have for paying off student loans for recent graduates or for students that are about to graduate?
Well, student loans are interesting. There's two types of student loans. There's federal student loans and private student loans. Federal student loans are issued by the government. The rules are a lot different and they're more beneficial to the individual that gets issued those federal loans because, you know, it's the government. They don't want to fleece you for money. But the private student loans are lenders, banks. They're a lot more stringent and stricter. At the end of the day, if you have student loans, try to maintain your payment. But let's take a step back. The less student loans you have, the better off you're going to be. And I say that because there's a way to graduate college with less student loans. You can get a job, you can, you know, doing whatever, part-time work, but more importantly, take some summer classes at community college, because community colleges are less expensive than maybe Syracuse University or some of the private schools. So try to limit your student loans and the amount you spend on college as much as you can, and try to defer that. But if, let's say, you're going out and getting some student loans and you graduate with student loans, or you know you're graduating, you, once you graduate, you have 6 months to as a leeway before you start paying for those student loans. The private student loans are one issue. The government loans are another. Government loans, there's more flexibility for you to consolidate. And right now, if you're recently graduating with student loans, the rates have dropped substantially because the government issued lower interest rates to try to help the economy with this pandemic that I'm sure everybody is involved in. And so we have been able to go through and at debt.com and advise people on how to get a lower rate on your student loans by consolidating. And there are a tremendous amount of opportunities out there if you can lower your student loan rate, if you can lower it.
So what are some other things students could do if their debt becomes like insurmountable? Like, what could they do to, if it just gets too much?
Well, the fact of the matter is, if they can't make their payments, they got to look at their budget. They should be looking at their budget. And we're not talking, you know, just one little issue in their budget, a budget. Go to debt.com. There's plenty of opportunities for people to build a budget. Most of us don't know how to build a budget. It is really freaking boring to make a budget, but it is so important. And basically figure out what you're spending on your rent, on your car payment, on your student loans, going out to bars, going out to clubs, you know, and then you work backwards. How much money do I have to spend? And then if you're in a deficit, you go through and you start to cut down your expenses. Go through. Do I really need bottle service, or can I mooch off Scott Dvorkin? That's my suggestion. All you brothers, mooch off this kid. He has my credit card, so.
No, I don't.
But the reality is, go through and work out a budget that fits what you're making. A lot of kids go through and they think that they can get an apartment for $2,500 a month. They could get a brand new car coming out of school. They have, and you know what? They got to get a new wardrobe. There's a lot of expenses. Mom and dad aren't going to pay for your bills anymore, Junior. You got to do it on your own. So you have to work backwards. So maybe you buy a used car instead of a brand new car until you get your student loans paid off. But budget, budget, budget. Figure out, maybe if I make a payment and a half, two, double my payments, I'm going to get out of debt that much sooner. Also, there are plenty of programs under the last presidential administration. Programs came out that the government will actually forgive you for those debts if you work for a nonprofit for 10 years or if you work in a government position. They will actually abate your loans after you work there for a decade. But you have to apply and you have to register. And the clock starts ticking when you file for that. Not, I have plenty of clients that have gone and said, you know, oh, I've worked for the government for 5 years. Well, guess what? It's another 10 years because you didn't apply when the program came out. So you got to watch yourself. Do the research, ask questions. And frankly, you guys are students and you should spend some time and understand what you're getting into. And by the way, I've known people and I've worked with people that have had the same student loans for 10 years. I've had people that have had the loans for 20 years, 25 years. But the government changed its law back in the last recession. If your loans, if it's a governmental loan, and your loans you're paying for 25 years, they're done, whatever the balance is. But frankly, if you're paying for 25 years, shame on you. You're done. You need to go through and pay those damn loans off, because all you're doing is giving away your money. And I'm not saying that you're stupid. You need to go through and make sure you understand that loan is an obligation and it can follow you the rest of your life if you're not careful. Some people come to us and say, Howard, I haven't paid my loans in 10 years. Well, guess what? You're going to pay your loans, because they don't go away. They will follow you to your grave. And the amount of interest, you may start out with a loan for $10,000 and you stop paying for it for a couple of years. All of a sudden that $10,000 turns into $20,000 or $30,000. You have to pay your student loans. They are, and the government will take your tax returns, tax refunds, if you go through and don't make your payments. So there's a lot of bad stuff that could happen. I had one fella that he had some student loans, and he was a doctor, and a lot of AEPI guys turn into doctors, and those are good docs, so stick with those guys. But at the end of the day, if you don't pay your student loans, the government takes your Medicare payments to pay for your student loans. So they're going to get you one way or the other. So there.
Perfect. So how would you tell people to approach their student loans at different phases of their life? So as an undergraduate, as a recent graduate, and say 10 years in the future?
That's a great question. I mean, certainly, listen, if you're in school, first of all, what's my advice for staying for school, for grad school? Stay in school as long as you can, because it's fun. You party. But the reality is it's tough out there. So try to get an education that makes sense. You get a very similar education whether you go to University of Miami, which I graduated, I got a master's from, or FAU. Brilliant program at FAU, actually. And this is true. I prefer Debt.com, probably has 30 people working with degrees from FAU. We have a massive internship program out of there, and we have for years. And they're smart kids, and we don't hire from Miami, simply for a couple of reasons, but at the end of the day, it's the same education. It's the same books. They're just a different degree. Stay in school as long as you can, get as much education as you can, and be as marketable as you can. And I will tell you that it is smarter for people to have advanced degrees to make themselves more marketable. Sometimes it's hard to swallow. That's a hard pill. What I would suggest is, if you can't afford grad school and you don't want to stay in school and continue to accumulate debt, and we're going to talk about credit card debt in a few short minutes, but maybe go with an employer that has a tuition reimbursement program. A lot of employers do, where you work for them and they will, you can get a master's or an MBA or whatever you're doing, and they'll pay for it, and you get it at night or on the weekends, and they will pay for it. So, and that's a great deal. At the end, the question was, what do we do in the future? I mean, you have to make your payments. Never stop making your payments. But don't be afraid to pick up the phone and talk to your student loan servicer to try to get a better deal for yourself. It's frustrating because the people, chances are the people that are answering the phone when you call, know less than you do about student loans. Make sure you understand and do the research yourself, because at the end of the day, they only know this much, and they don't care about what your problem is, because they got 10,000 people that they talk to every single day. And the fact of the matter is you better care, because you're going to be married to that student loan for a very, very long time.
Definitely. So you mentioned credit cards. How do students balance their credit card debt and their student loan debt?
Well, you got to be careful with credit card debt. And I have counseled many, many people over the years, young kids that get a credit card, they've never had a credit card, and they were never taught how to use a credit card. And when you're in school, you get issued credit cards, but nobody tells you how to use them. And frankly, you're all of a sudden, you have a $1,000 bill and you're saying, how do I pay this? I have no job, but I owe $1,000. So you need to do some education. You need to educate yourself. The reality is try to stick with the debit card. That's what Scotty D has. And when you hit him up for drinks, make sure he uses his debit card and not my freaking credit card, because I will hunt you down for that. But anyway, make sure that you go through and only use a credit card in emergencies. I have, as I said, I've counseled plenty of kids that have used credit cards, got multiple credit cards issued to them, because you're prime bait. As a college student, there is a study that has been done, many studies, that if you're issued a credit card in college, and it may have the name on that, the school name on that card, whatever your school is, or not, you will hold that card for 15 years on average, because you got it in college. As opposed to the other people that didn't get that card, there's only a four-year hold, they use that card for 4 years. So you have to understand that you are prime meat for a credit card marketer. A guy like me, I'm going to target you, and I'm going to try to hook you, and it's like crack, baby. You without that credit card, there is no pain. You're cool. You're signing away, and you're walking away. Guess what? Until 30 days later when the bill comes in. Now, let's use this this thing. Let's see. This stuff. What's this stuff? What is this stuff?
Money.
It's money. Man, you don't want to let this stuff go. And I'll tell you why. By the way, this is a Jewish bankroll. The dollars are on the outside. If I was Italian where I grew up, the hundreds would be on the inside or on the outside. But I grew up with all Italians. I could get away with it. I have my chain, and I drove a Camaro also, so I can do this. But the reality is, the truth is that, you know, the green stuff, the cash that I just showed you, it's tough to get it out of your fingers. You don't want to let that stuff go. There's pain, but credit cards are easy. I will tell you, I've had several people that were in our programs over the years. I've been doing this for a long time. I'm an old fat man with a lot of stories. So at the end of the day, I've had people that have really, they had to drop out of school because of too much credit card debt, and you gotta watch it. In fact, and I never had one on my program, but a couple of these kids got issued credit cards with the school's name on it and ended up killing themselves, unfortunately, because of the stress that it put under them. And you don't want to end up that way or any way. Don't use credit cards.
So it's a great lesson. So growing up, you're always told to save your money, save your money. How do students balance saving money and paying off their debt?
Well, first of all, students don't have any money. So that's the hard part. You guys don't have jobs, so where are you going to get your money? Some of you do, but some of you don't. At the end of the day, you should save your money. Set up a bank account, go through, try to save your money as much as you possibly can, but you do not run a balance on your credit cards. The credit cards, guess what? You run a $1,000 balance, you get charged 28%. That's your credit card balance at the end of the year, if all you're paying is going to be another $300 in interest. It just goes up proportionally and compounds. So you can't run balances on your credit cards. At the end of the day, these banks are not your friend. They are sucking you in, and they are not going to let go. Credit card debt in general is the greatest non-discriminator of all times. It doesn't care if you're short, fat, purple, blue, doesn't matter. It's going to latch onto you, and it is not going to let you go at any time soon until you make the call that said, I've had enough. I don't want to be a slave to the credit card companies, and pay your bills off. So whatever you have to do. I also want to mention something. When you get out of school and you go for a job, there are, I see a lot of younger people avoid putting money into their company's retirement plan. And they should definitely do that. You're giving away a raise if the company matches that retirement plan. So you may put in $10 and they may give you an extra $5 every week or whatever the case may be. So don't be foolish. Don't think that $10 or that $100 is going to matter, because that $100, if you don't do it, is going to be taxed with federal taxes, with employment taxes. So that $100 that you put in every week could be $150, or it could be down to $50, depending on where you live between your state taxes, your federal taxes.
So you mentioned putting money away. What do you think is the best way to set up like a retirement plan? Would you use like a 401k, a Roth IRA, or put money into like the stock market?
Well, I will tell you that you should, if your company offer, and it's funny, we're talking about retirement plans to kids without jobs, but you're eventually, hopefully you're going to have a job unless your last name is Dvorkin. So, but the fact of the matter is, you know, you should, if the company offers a 401k, then put that into a 401k. If your company offers they don't offer a retirement plan, then do an IRA. And you could put as much as $5,000 into that IRA. And do a Roth IRA. In a Roth, there's two types of IRAs. One is a regular IRA, which is tax deductible now, which is great. And one is called a Roth IRA. What a Roth IRA does, you pay the taxes, but you don't pay tax on the amount that it grows to. And if you're coming out at 22, you know, you work till 62, you got 40 years of growth that you will not have to pay tax on. And your amount of money will be astronomical. And you'll say, I remember this fat son of a gun on this 80 pie call told me to do these Roth IRAs and put my money away, and thank you, Howie D. So at the end of the day, the reality is this, guys. Money is important to all of us. You know, there's lots of important things, and you need to do the research and understand it. Money and there's a couple things that can really make your life great and make your life bad. Just don't make stupid mistakes. I hate seeing smart people make dumb mistakes. Make sure you pay yourself first. That's great advice. Make sure you pay yourself first. What that means? What does that mean, Scott Dvorkin?
What?
That pay yourself first. That means if you make a paycheck, you make $1,000 a week. Let's say you make $1,000 a week. You sit there, you get taxes, you do that. But let's just say you make, after taxes, you get to take home $800 a week. Take $100 and put it into either a savings account or a retirement account. Make sure that you pay your debt first. If you have credit card balances, make sure those bills don't accumulate because you're getting charged 28%. I will tell you, anybody, that you are not, no matter what, you're not going to get a consistent return on your money of 28%. And if you do, I will gladly give you every dime I have and you can invest it, because it's impossible to get those types of returns consistently. So pay your debt off first. Student loans, it may take you a little longer, pay that off. You're going to want to graduate. You're going to want to buy a car. New cars, they want to sell new cars. So some of the kinds they have first buyer programs, all the American companies have that. And they will go through and they will give you $500 towards that. Some companies say, we'll give you zero interest for the next 5 years, which is great. But frankly, they're making money on you somewhere. But at the end of the day, you need to look at, do you need a new car? It's always nice to have a new car, but does it make sense if you have a pile of debt sitting over here? Sometimes it's better to get a used car, cheap used car, and pay that debt down. You're looking at somebody that never paid an interest, a dime in interest. And I had a mortgage on my house probably for 2 years when on my first house back in the early 90s, and I just got tired of making payments, so I just paid it off. But the reality is, I'm not a normal person. I'm out of my mind. I practice what I preach. Don't make the banks rich. Pay yourself. Make yourself rich. That's the important thing.
So we have a bunch of questions rolling in from the audience, so I'm going to touch on some of those. This one says, do you see layaway as a viable option to manage expenses? And how likely does layaway increase during recessions like now?
Layaway. Does it even exist? Layaway is stupid. Why do you need layaway? What is it? You give $5? What are we, in the 1950s? Come on, man. You either want it. There's no such thing as layaway. It doesn't really exist anymore because we got these things called credit cards. And if you want immediate satisfaction, you're going to put it on your credit card and you're going to walk out of the store with it that day. Layaway does not make sense, because let's just say a store has a layaway plan. You go to Walmart and you want this TV. Guess what? By the time you make all your payments for the layaway, that TV's outdated and there's a new TV, you know, who knows, 20K or whatever the heck they call that. So layaway doesn't make sense.
When do you start paying student loans out of college? How many years?
6 months after you graduate college. Now you can ask for another deferment and you'll probably get it. But remember, the clock is ticking, guys. You are still getting charged interest. And you know what? Maybe a low interest if it's a federal loan, maybe a higher interest if it's a private loan, you're still getting charged interest. So doesn't make sense deferring it, kicking the can down the street. Doesn't help you when you're carrying debt, because the banks are going to own your ass. That's the truth.
Yeah. So there's a lot of questions about like refinancing student loans. So I'm guessing that's not the best idea, or?
It's a great idea. It's a terrific idea, and you should do it and explore the options. SoFi is a big player in that business. Student loans, we are partners on a student loan site. I think it's called studentdebtrelief.us. At the end of the day, there's a lot of great articles out there. That's one of our companies. And it'll teach you a lot of stuff to help you. It's run by some of the guys at debt.com. But at the end of the day, SoFi does a great job of refinancing student loan debt. Also, your government, there's a government program where you can fill out the paperwork yourself and not pay anything, and you could save yourself a ton of money, especially now. Interest rates are low, very low. So take advantage of it. So you may have signed up for student loans at 7% interest, but now, because of the recent economic turmoil, those 7%, you may be able to refinance your student loans at 4% or 3%, whatever the case may be. So definitely explore. But again, you need to educate yourself on what's out there.
So do you think it's worth paying off student loans while you're still in college?
As long as somebody else is paying them, hell yeah. No, the reality is, listen, guys, if you have the money, yes. I mean, it's low interest. It's a low interest loan, a student loan. So it is, you'll do better paying off if you have other debt. I mean, when you go and you have different debts, you have a buffet of debt. You could have credit card debt. You could have debt on your car. You could have student loans. You might even come out and buy yourself a house and get a mortgage. You have to evaluate what the differences are on that. On the mortgage, you get some tax breaks available, federal and state. So there's some benefit to carrying mortgage. There's good debt and there's bad debt. Bad debt is credit card debt. You go through and you went out to dinner and you took your girl to dinner and you spent $100, $500, whatever the case may be. You put it on your credit card, you don't pay that. That's bad debt. Mortgage, good debt. And why that's good debt is because hopefully your house will appreciate. Let's talk about your car. It's good debt. Good debt. You got to have your wheels so you can get to the job so you can pay your bills. So that's okay debt. Credit card, student debt is good debt. You got something for it. You got an education, and they can't take that away from you. I always tell Scotty D here, I go, there's a couple things. They can't take your education away from you. So go and learn that, and that is yours. And he says, who are they? And I say, the man. So, no, seriously, guys. I mean, listen, I am a big fan of educate yourself. Do it while you're young. If you don't go to grad school right out of school, and I know some people can't, the reality is, you know, there's a good chance you're not going to go to grad school. And in today's society, it is competitive. A lot of smart people running around there, a lot of people with great degrees out there, and you need to shine. So go to grad school, educate yourselves, and be the best you can. But I will tell you, if I can give people a little lesson, it's a competitive world. You're not going to be the smartest guy out there. The fact of the matter is, the only real equalizer is work harder. If you work harder than everybody else and outwork them, you will shine. I promise you. I'm not the smartest guy in the world, but I'll be damned if there's anybody that works harder than me. Nobody. And the fact of the matter is, that's what you got to do to be successful. You got to sacrifice. And sacrifice a lot of things, and I have sacrificed. I just started talking to him. I didn't know till he was 18, right? I'm just joking. But the reality is, you got to make your sacrifices. You know, I decided early on I was going to outwork everybody, and it kind of paid off.
Perfect. We have two more questions. A bunch of people are asking, what is a government program to refinance your loans called?
Used to be the Obama program, and now it's just student refi. But those are only for student loan refi. But those are only for government, federal loans. The other loans, the private loans, if you remember about an hour ago, I was telling you about private loans. Those are a different program. The federal loans are much more beneficial to refinance. And you need to go out and go to either debt.com, and they can hook you up certainly the studentdebtrelief.us has a tremendous amount of information about student loans on it, and I strongly suggest that you go out there and read some of the stuff that's on that site, because it's very clear what that offers. And actually, if you have private loans, there's a little link on there, and it can take you to a company that will refinance your private loans. So it's kind of a cool site.
Awesome. This question is a little sidestep away from student debt and finance. This is from one of my brothers. His name's Alex Zan. I'm sure you heard of him.
I know Alex Zan. He's running for Parkland City Commission. And he is a great kid. And Alex Zan, believe it or not, I remember the day he was born, because his parents lived across from us when we lived in a different neighborhood. Jamie and Brian are great people. And I'm sure Alex, do you like Alex, by the way? Do you like Alex on this foot?
He's a good kid. I won't tell anybody. He's all right.
Okay. Okay. Should I vote for him?
Hey, he's AAPI. Why not?
Okay. That's right. By the way, and I make this, if you come to debt.com, we have 9 different companies. There's a lot of AAPI guys running around there. In fact, my top 2 or 3 guys are AAPI. So if you want to come to debt.com, Consolidated Credit, or any of the other businesses that we have, we'll try to find a home for you. I love hiring AAPI because they're smart kids and they know how to work and they're good people. We come from the same factory.
That's
so
great.
What was from Alex Zan? I'm sorry, I went off on a tangent, which I often do.
Alex wants to know if you had a mentor that guided you or helped you become successful, and if you had different mentors in your personal and professional life.
That's a great question, and mentors are important. I unfortunately, my father passed away when I was a kid, and it kind of beat me up pretty good. But I will tell you that my mother, who was a brilliant, strong, my biggest cheerleader, certainly mentored me. Scotty knew her. She was up to the day she died, she was a great woman. My father was a great guy, but he used to drag me out of bed when I was about 10 years old to go sweep floors and scrub toilets in his plumbing supply house. But I will tell you, I had mentors all through life and learned from those people. Going through my father, my mother, I played football in high school. I sucked at it, and maybe I got hit in the head a lot, and that's why I'm so freaking weird. But I will tell you that I learned a lot on that football field, and those guys taught me how to be a man. I turned around, I got out of school, and I got hired by a fella by the name of Al Ellentuck, who is still alive. I just talked to him a couple weeks ago. He's 88 years old, and he was probably the best merger and acquisition accountant in the country at the time. He was a Harvard-educated lawyer. He was a brilliant guy, and he took me under his wing, and he showed me how to be a great businessman. And I will tell you, I got the work ethic from my father. I got the street smarts from my father and mother. I got the toughness from those football coaches. And I got my smoothness. And I know you can't recognize that right now, but if you get me in a room, I'm pretty damn smooth. From Al Ellentuck. So there's 4 or 5 people that I credit my career to, but never stop learning. I wake up every morning at 5 a.m. and I read and I read. And I will tell you, these things, this is bad. You're not going to learn shit on social media. Nothing you will learn on social media. You can't even tell if it's real or not. Go through, find a place that's credible. Forbes magazine, if you're a business guy. Wall Street Journal, if you're a business guy. Whatever, you got to find credible resources. And even if it costs you a few dollars, educate yourself. I will tell you that every day from the time I was a sophomore in college, I got the Wall Street Journal, and my roommate and I read it cover to cover every single day. Guess what? When I go home, the Wall Street Journal is being delivered at my house. I've been subscribed to that darn newspaper and Forbes magazine for, I don't know, 40 years. That's a long time. Man, I'm old. But anyway, maybe 35 years. I won't date myself. You know, the funny part is I started learning about money by reading Money Magazine. And last week, you know, I got a call, and it was Money Magazine wanted to interview me, and they've interviewed me many, many times over the years. So it's kind of funny. They taught me everything I know about money, or started to, and they've been able to go through, and now they're asking me questions. By the way, I have two books, and if you write me or send me an email, I will send you either Credit Hell or Power Up. Credit Hell was a much more interesting book if you're in debt. It's a great book because it'll teach you how to get out of the book. Truthfully, it's a little boring, but it's good. The other book, Power Up, is how to not get out of into debt and stay out of debt. I will be happy to send any ape a free copy, and maybe I'll sign it also, which will be worth absolutely nothing. Actually, if I sign my book, they'll probably be worth less because you can't sell it on eBay or Amazon.
Well, Howard, I just want to thank you so much for taking your time and sharing your expertise with undergraduates across the nation. We've learned some great lessons, you know, pay your bills as soon as you get them, have your son buy all the Syracuse drinks, and just work hard.
And don't forget your letters, baby.
Yes, sir.
Honestly, AEPI means a lot. It may mean something right now to you, a fun time, but that brotherhood, I will tell each and every brother, it means something. When you sit there and you shake hands with somebody that's an AEPI all through your career, it means something. There's an automatic connection.
Great. Thank you so much, Howard. It was great speaking with you. It was great learning from you, and I look forward to reading your book and looking more into debt.com.
Great. Thank you so much for allowing me to talk to your guys. And again, there's a ton of opportunity out there. You just got to take it.
Great. Thank you so much. Have a great rest of your day.
Take care, guys. Thank you.